All right, we're back. Plenary session, virtual edition, Zoom edition. I'm joined by Chris Booth and Adam Fanditis. And we, the three of us, are the authors of a new paper. It's called, Has the Current Oncology Value Paradigm Forgotten Patients' Time? It's out in JAMA Oncology. I'm going to start by introducing my colleague, Chris Booth, professor of medicine, Kingston, Ontario, Canada, Queen's University, friend of the show. Chris, introduce us to Adam, introduce us to this paper.
Great. Thanks, Vinay, for having us. It's always a pleasure to chat on plenary session. So I'm going to hand over to Adam, who led this essay in a moment. I'll just introduce Adam. So Adam is a medical oncologist. He did his internal medicine training with us here at Queen's, and I got to know him then and work quite closely with him. He then went to University of Calgary to do his medical oncology training and then came back to Queen's to be my research fellow about a year and a half ago. And we had a lot of fun working with Adam. And then Adam has just moved on to a faculty position in British Columbia with the BC Cancer Agency in Victoria. So he's just in the midst of moving. And in addition to being an excellent writer, a wonderful physician, and a really creative thinker, Adam's hidden talents are that he was, and this is probably what got him into the fellowship program when I told a department head, is he's an exceptionally good freestyle rapper, and he's very good at surfing. So I'll leave it at that. Maybe later in the interview, we'll get into those things. But Adam, I'll hand over to you in a moment to walk us through your essay. But like all good research projects and commentaries, I think the backstory is often quite interesting. So like most things that I do in life now that are of any interest, this goes back to the legendary waterfall hike in rural Oregon. I can't remember if it was the waterfall hike or when we were having beers in Kingston on the shores of Lake Ontario. Mm-hmm. But one of the conversations that came up was Vinay and I were chatting about value frameworks and benefit and endpoints. And he was going off about his usual surrogacy PFS thing. And I was going off about my usual kind of 6 weeks PFS thing. And then we realized that there's a concept that really is not well described or talked about. And we at the time used the term kind of opportunity cost. It's a way to represent when we're giving therapies, and especially in the palliative context, that have very small benefits, there's other things that the patient gives up in addition to side effects and financial costs. There are these other unspoken opportunity costs that really do not get well articulated when we have these discussions with patients. And so that led, I think, to the genesis of this essay. And I'll hand over to you, Adam, now to maybe walk us through some of the concepts that we've outlined in the paper.
Well, I'm just going to take a slight detour and say that this essay was actually one of the hardest things that I think probably both of us have ever had to write, because it was actually like 17 different essays that we originally tried to fit into one. And it started interfacing with a bunch of different things like the economics literature, where we found out that opportunity cost is not probably the word to use.
Right. I got mad about that, yeah.
And perhaps shadow costs is actually a better term. So things that people give up that rightly or wrongly is probably down to us not communicating, you know, the true cost of any given treatment. Because even as oncologists, we tend to fixate so strongly on these endpoints that came from trials. And so overall survival being the thing that matters to everyone, but also, you know, quality of life and things like that. But there are other intangible things that are also not necessarily captured by current quality of life metrics. And the big one that we kind of talk about in this paper is time that's lost to treatment, whether that's someone who goes through a ton of side effects and ends up hospitalized for, you know, a period of weeks, or whether it's just, you know, kind of the day-to-day costs of going to your appointments, getting blood work, and then getting chemo, you know, whether it's every week or every 2 weeks or every 3 weeks, and how that looks as we go through, you know, first-line treatment, second-line treatment, and third-line treatment. And then I think the big thing that really I took away from this is it really is most important near kind of the end of life and later line treatments, where a lot of the time we're applying data that didn't necessarily apply to that population in the first place. And so you're talking about a person who's, you know, not necessarily super well, and you're talking about giving them more treatment that probably is not going to be beneficial, especially because they're going to have to give up a lot of their remaining time to just get the treatment. And so that's kind of the overarching idea behind the paper. And I don't know if you want to go through more
That's helpful, really, Adam. And I think, I mean, I'll let Vinay kind of jump in a moment, but I mean, you know, these are really important and practical elements of the cancer journey for patients. You know, the opportunity to spend time with loved ones, with family, with friends, to go fishing, to pursue their interests, to maybe work, to travel. And by virtue of coming into the cancer center and then getting sick with our treatments, you know, we take away those opportunities. And you know, I think as you wrote very eloquently in the early part of the essay, you know, when the treatment benefit is large, the relative loss of this amount of time becomes perhaps less important. But when the treatment benefit is small and time is short at the end of life, all of a sudden this lost opportunity or these lost experiences become really, really important. And it occasionally does come up. I'm actually surprised it doesn't come up that often, but patients will say, if the chemotherapy is that much benefit, am I just going to spend all that time in hospital? And I'm surprised it doesn't come up more often. But what does come up, and I think all of us probably get a bit of a sick feeling in our stomach, is when we hear someone say, oh no, I'm not going to go to my cousin's wedding because I don't want to delay my treatment. Or I'm not going to go camping next weekend because, you know, I'm due for chemo and I just want to make sure that I'm here on time for it. And I think those are areas where we can perhaps have more honest discussions and help navigate with our patients through.
That's so well put. You know, the things that jump in my mind when I think about the cost is, like, I want anyone who's embarking on a bone marrow transplant, for somebody to calculate, for people with this indication, this chromosomal abnormalities, this risk cytogenetics getting transplant, how many days do you spend in the hospital and out of the hospital? I mean, that's a nice research idea. I think about people enrolling on phase 1, phase 2 clinical trials at the end of life. And you think about all the extra PKPD visits for blood draws and all the infusion visits. And you start to ask yourself, you know, even if this drug gives somebody an extra month, how much of that month do we take back by bringing them here, driving back and forth to the hospital and having to stay here or having to do a blood test? And I think this essay kind of gets at this, which is, you know, time is precious for all of us. It's even more precious as the less you have of it. And the point you made really well, Chris, is like, if the drug is giving you another year, then sure, losing a few days here or there for visits, totally reasonable. The drug's only giving you 3 weeks, 2 weeks, 10 days, like erlotinib. The price of even one day of nausea, one day of diarrhea, it can offset so much of that. I think that's really what this essay is getting at.
Adam, can you walk us through the pancreas cancer example? Because that's a really common disease. Treatments we give every day in clinic. And you know, there was some data that might help inform that.
Yeah, so the pancreas data that Chris is talking about is a paper, I think it's by Band, is how I pronounce it at all. But what they did was actually pretty interesting, is they just basically quantified the amount of time that patients are spending, you know, going to appointments, including travel time. And this isn't including blood draws or hospitalization at all. So it's actually probably an underestimate of the amount of time that patients are spending at the cancer center. And so they follow patients through their kind of pancreatic cancer journey and ultimately find that 10% of the days that they are alive are spent getting cancer treatment. And when you think about, you know, the average survival of metastatic pancreatic cancer, even in trials, being between, you know, 10 months to a year kind of thing, that's actually quite a substantial amount of time for a treatment that usually gives, you know, either 1 or 2 months of benefit potentially. And so it kind of is the exact same as the point you were making, Vinay, was that, you know, if all of your time that you're gaining is actually spent in the cancer center, is that worthwhile? And that answer is actually different from person to person, right? And so I just think it's something that we are bad at emphasizing and actually bad at, you know, calculating or following, because at the end of the day, every single treatment is actually different in terms of the actual time cost to a patient. And this is something else that we actually touch on in the paper, is that there is reasonable data that most patients prefer oral therapy to IV therapy. And one of the theories arising from that paper is that it's probably because of the amount of time that they're saving without having to go into the hospital. They can just take it at home. So they're actually not really losing time the same way someone who's getting, you know, gemcitabine every, you know, like week for 3 weeks on is losing. And so I just think it's something that's interesting to think about, that each treatment does have a unique time cost that is different than its actual side effect cost.
Yeah, no, it's well put, Adam. I'm gonna paraphrase a paragraph in here, and it comes from one of my teachers in oncology. I'm sure as you guys have had too. So many of my great teachers have been my patients. And this comes from a published essay or commentary I actually wrote with this patient, so I can say her name, it's the public domain. So is this Penny Nelson, who is a very dear patient who had metastatic small bowel cancer and taught me a lot and ended up wanting to kind of share her pearls of wisdom with the oncology community. So we published this in the Canadian Medical Association Journal a couple of years ago, just shortly actually, but the paper finally came out in press just shortly after she died. And so I'll just read here because there's some, I think, some powerful lessons that again come from Penny's voice, which was in the back of my mind when I was helping Adam and Vinay write this. As we write, while time has intrinsic value for all people, the concept of limited time becomes more acute in the context of an incurable illness. In the face of terminal bowel cancer, one patient referred to time lost for medical care as appointmentitis. In this narrative account, the patient reminds us that the diagnosis of cancer quickens time and patients lose patience. The good doctor will realize this. High treatment burden is costly beyond the financial sense, with direct effects on patients' professional, social, and family life. This cost increases with later lines of therapy, which typically offer smaller gains, but require increasing time in the cancer center.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's spot on. I think about, you know, when you really imagine the day in the life of a cancer patient getting an infusion, people may not fully appreciate, but what do you have to do? Often you have to get there early the day of and get the blood work done because there's a 90-minute gap before you even get a result. And the doctor won't even give you the dose of medicine until they see the LFTs or the CBC or whatever. Then you got to, you know, go off, get a cup of coffee, maybe walk around, waste, you know, 90 minutes, come back, check in, fill out that clipboard asking questions that are very silly because we know all this information about the person, but they had to fill it out. And then they got to wait their turn to be called, get taken to the first room, sit in their room, get your blood pressure taken, your temperature taken, and wait until you get to the second room. The second room is the classic, the butcher paper on the table, and you got to decide where you want to sit while you wait for your doctor. The doctor comes eventually, sits, talks to you, makes sure you're clear for your infusion, says, okay. Or you're seen by a nurse and the nurse clears you for your infusion. And then you go back to the next step, access the port, get things going, talk to pharmacy, have them send the bag. And so quickly, you know, half the day is gone. The whole day is gone. I always tell people, depending on the regimen, you know, expect to spend 6 hours, 8 hours. And we forget that that is a huge time sink, I think. And when you're feeling ill, waking up early, it's exhausting for people. I know people talk about how exhausted they are even the day after, because this is a sick cancer patient. And those are all kind of impositions we make with the promise that what we're giving is something that justifies the impositions. But I think the purpose of this essay was to draw attention to the fact that often we don't calculate that. When you talk about 10% of the time a pancreas cancer patient is getting treatment, that's significant. But I want to say one thing, Chris. That doesn't justify the control arm of Polo trial. That was still bad. That was still bad. Don't get away by saying I spared them that time in the hospital. That was still an inadequate control arm. However,
You're right. So I guess just to throw it back to you guys. So what do you think moving forward are some of the actionable items that our community should take, recognizing that? And I think, you know, it was Dr. Sledge, who was the handling editor at JAMA Oncology, who you know, was very gracious to accept our essay. And in one of his letters to us, he actually used the term time toxicity, which I actually hadn't used or heard before. And I think, you know, Dr. Sledge, I don't know if he coined it or not, but I think we should, you know, start to promote the concept and the use of that term within our field, time toxicity. So I think the first step is just to begin acknowledging this more explicitly with patients. And I mean, Adam, you had some thoughts about how to measure this, I think, because it's hard for us to quantify it. I mean, Vinay just kind of went on a monologue about how long it is for the patient the day, but someone should probably measure that.
I mean, we talked about this very briefly. I mean, you could definitely measure it like in terms of a lot of different like mechanisms, with the most sophisticated being like geotagging people and seeing how much time they're actually spending in any given location while you're doing a trial, but that's obviously more expensive. There's other ways where if, you know, you pilot a new drug or whatever, you could actually just ask people how much time they estimated that they spent at the cancer center, and you would get a reasonable, you know, result, whether that's right or not. You know, everything is imperfect if you measure it that way. But I think more importantly, kind of alluding to what you said, just acknowledging it is probably the first step. But when I started thinking about this, the thing I thought most about was like the way that health systems are designed somewhat. And in COVID, we actually saw a shift where our system changed somewhat. And in some cases, it changed in a way that alleviated at least some of the time toxicity associated with cancer treatment.
Good point.
And so for us in Kingston, we did have patients who come for like 2 hours just to see us to say, oh yeah, you can get treatment in a different place, for example. So they're wasting an inordinate amount of time driving. And with the kind of phone visits that we were able to do, in some cases, I would say, you know, we managed to provide at least close to the level of care from a cancer point of view, while minimizing time toxicity, even within the existing framework that we have for drugs and how they're given. And so I think that's kind of the first step is, you know, knowing that, you know, no matter what drug we're doing, there is probably some flexibility that can be built into the health system to help minimize these time toxicities, and at least make the experience better for the average patient. But that's going to be so variable from, you know, the health system in the States to Canada, to Sweden, to wherever, right? Those are just kind of my initial thoughts hearing that.
Right. That's a great point. Yeah, geotracking is a lot easier these days ever since we put that microchip in that COVID vaccine.
Yeah, no comment on that one.
Okay, no,
why don't you have the closing word on this? Where do you think we need to go as a community?
You know, I agree with that a lot. I agree that those are excellent points. I mean, yeah, I think, you know, you opened this whole door in my mind of like the way we have, you know, somebody who have breast cancer localized and it's treated and they're free of recurrence and we're making them drive in. And that's a time toxicity to some degree, a survivor time toxicity. I'm also thinking about the drugs. I think, you know, Chris, you know, you've done so much work on, you know, clinically meaningful benefits and getting into that. And actually time toxicity is a nice way to build into that. Cause I think one thing we'll all agree on is you can't approve a drug that it takes longer to administer the drug than the drug gives you in survival. Like that's a bare minimum. You know, we cannot approve these drugs. It takes more to administer than to give back. And that might be a low bar, but then the next bar is, you know, what's the clinically meaningful benefit? And maybe those discussions, that's a nice place to put it in. But I think even thinking about it is the first step. If I were to encourage people listening to this podcast, I would say wherever you are, this is the perfect research project for anybody. Any cancer center, you can get local IRB approval, do a retrospective review, and pick some disease that we haven't thought about, maybe AML, ALL, poor risk cytogenetics, or maybe bladder cancer, and start to go through. You know, avelumab has some benefit in Javelin 100, but how much of that is lost when you start factoring in all those visits? And what does the real world look like? How many visits do people get on average who are on avelumab? You pick the setting, but start to calculate that. And the more papers we get, like that wonderful pancreas cancer patient, pancreas time patient paper, the better we will all be and more we'll know about this. So those are my thoughts. Chris, last word?
No, just thanks, Adam, for doing the heavy lifting on this. It was a nice essay. As you said, we went through a lot of convolutions and a lot of discussions, but I think, it certainly will inform. I've had my eyes opened by this discussion and writing the essay, and I think it's going to become, especially, you know, we're talking to patients in clinic about second, third, or fourth line therapies. I think I'll try to do a better job of being more explicit and at least acknowledging that, you know, we've talked about the side effects that are going to come with this therapy, but we should also talk about the time trade-offs. And I think that's an important part of holistic, compassionate cancer care.
Chris Booth, Adam Fundidis. The paper's out now, JAMA Oncology. People check it out. Thanks for doing this.
Thanks for having me.